welcome you, and we're glad that you chose to come out and spend this little time with us. It is a time for us to showcase what we're doing in our schools with the resources that you have so generously provided. And we'll talk a little bit about what's new, what is on the horizon, some of the things that we are doing, and then we will engage you in some discussions to gather some input from you to, that we can use to make ourselves even better than we are. So that's pretty much the short version of tonight's format. But before we do that, I just want to ask you, if you have not yet helped yourself to some refreshments, please do go to the table in the back. The refreshments were prepared by Mrs. McCabe and the students in her culinary class at the high school. So we'll give you a few minutes to do that. Grab some water, some juice, cookies, other goodies back there, and we'll give you time to do that, and then we'll get started. Okay, good evening again, everyone, and welcome to the East Granby Public Schools 2016 Annual Forum. We're glad you're here. It's always nice to see you, and we're just thrilled to have this opportunity to share with you a lot of information about what we do in our schools, and give you an opportunity to see perhaps some of your children at work in our classrooms and engaged in a number of activities. Before we get further into our program, I do have a few people I would like to introduce to you this evening, some of whom know because they live in our community. But I want to begin by introducing our guest speaker for this evening, Janet Garagliano. And Janet has had a long career in education. We, for some reason, followed each other's footsteps through a few school appointments. I was in one particular school community as an administrator, and when I left, Janet followed and took my slot. Janet is involved in some very important work, helping school districts in Connecticut to revitalize their instructional practices, looking at our learning standards and trying to find ways to engage students more actively in the learning process, helping them to look at the standards and to work from a personal learning plan, carve out their own pathway toward that deeper learning. So she will be talking with you a little bit about mastery-based learning, where we give students the opportunity to really delve deeper into the content, the curriculum, the subject matter, so that they are better informed and develop greater mastery of that particular subject, unit, topic, theme that they're pursuing. She will tell you more about it. I certainly don't want to steal her thunder. But we do welcome you, Janet, to East Granby. Janet had been here before. She did present to our Board of Education earlier last year. And now she is back to share more with us. She will tell us a little bit also about the progress that other school districts have made that have that took the step before us to embark in this path. Also this evening we have with us our first selectman, Mr. Jim Hayden. Welcome, thank you. And sitting next to him is our chair of our East Granby Board of Finance, Mr. Dave Kilbon. Standing in the back to my left is the chair of our East Granby Board of Education, Mr. Joe Doring. We have some additional board members present. Michelle Holt, who is vice chair of the Board of Ed. Jim Feeding, board member. And in the back is Mr. M. Tom Short. I also have to acknowledge two of our former board members, Mr. Jim Brennan and Frank Lee. To have you come up here because Mr. Logie spent some time on the Board of Ed with us last year, and we had a ceremony not too long ago where we recognized our board members for their time of service with us, and Mr. Logie unfortunately could not be there that night. Now I have a captive audience. So I want to take this opportunity to present to you this plaque in recognition of your service to the East Granby Public Schools and your East Granby community.
Great, thank you.
Thank you so much.
Very well.
There's nothing like seizing the moment. And then to my right, this esteemed group, part of my leadership team, the group that I taunt with emails and text messages and odd hours of the day, let's just leave it there. A very diligent, very dedicated, very committed group of educators. I don't think you'll find a finer group anywhere. We work hard, we work smart, we work efficiently. We are deeply engaged in our work and committed to professional learning, professional development, not just for ourselves, but also for our faculty and our staff. And ultimately, that translates into having very high standards and learning expectations for our students, your children. So let me introduce to you Stella Ross, who is our Director of Curriculum. Next to her is Mr. Christopher Roach. Next to him is Ms. Karen Gogel. She is our director of services. Ms. Mela Eulinger, principal of over here, Mr. Bob McGrath. He's the assistant principal for high school. And I really should say the assistant principal for the whole district, because he has so many district-wide duties, he's everywhere. So Bob, we thank you for that. Next to him, Mr. David Pelling, who is the proud principal. And next to him, Missy Bavaro Granby, who is proud principal of East Granby Middle School. Her teachers, I think, are making their way around the state, winning all kinds of awards and recognitions, Teacher of the Year for this and that, and all kinds of wonderful things that you will see in the slideshow in a moment. In the back is Mrs. Susan Greco. She's our district business manager. And the lady with that wonderful voice that you hear when you call the office, Lisa Klein. And I'm Dr. Christine Mahoney, superintendent of schools. And I have to say that I'm very proud to be part of the East Granby Public Schools and to be a part of this community. A number of things we're going to be doing this evening. First of all, we want you to enjoy our refreshments. Toward the end of the evening, we will have some door prizes that we will share with you. But there are two other important things that we will be doing this evening. The first is we have provided you with index cards and pens. And that is because we are going to ask you to participate in feedback sessions. We'll have you work in groups, and I have four questions or five questions for five groups of people. And when we get to that point, we'll get you into groups so that you'll be sure to get a nice mix of perspectives in each group. So that's for later on. I also am going to ask you, those of you who are parents of elementary age students, if you could help us out by completing this, these survey forms, What we're trying to do is to get a better sense of how many students we will have in our elementary classrooms next year. So those of you who are here will be able to complete this form for us and hand it in before you leave. For your neighbors who are not here, we are going to be sending it home with the students so that they can then complete the form and return it to the principal for Carl Aldrove School or R.D. Seymour School, wherever your child attends school. So for those of you who are here tonight, please remember to fill this out for us. And hopefully this will give us a better opportunity to make sure that we have our staffing appropriate for the beginning of next school year. So before you leave, you will have one of these yellow cards in your hand. And for our viewers at home, we will be putting this online as well, so that you may be able to print it off at home, complete it, and send it back in to us in the school. So please do complete these for us. It's very important. At this time, I would like to ask our board chair, Mr. Joe Doring, to come forward and give a welcome message.
Thank you, Dr. Henry. First, welcome to everyone. Thank you for coming out and attending our community forum. I'd also like to thank our guest speaker for being here this evening. And also, I'd like to thank Dr. Henry and her team for putting all of this together. It's through opportunities like this that we can share information, and it's wonderful to have you attend so we can do so. I'll be brief so we can get right to the program. I think we have a couple hours planned this evening, so I'll turn it back over to Dr. Henry. Thank you once again.
Thank you. Thank you. So I could stand here, or the team could stand here and tell you what the students do from day to day in our schools. But it's so much more fun to be able to watch them doing that. So we have put together for you a slideshow showing you student activity in all four of our schools. I wanted everyone to have an opportunity to really sit and take it in. You know, if it were running and you came in and you just kind of browsed past it, that's okay. But we really want you to get a sense of what is really happening in our classrooms, and I'm not going to spoil the show, basically, by telling you what you're going to be seeing. It's better that you take it in and look at it through your own lenses and see really how we're working with our students. And Janet will pick up on some of that later on. So for those of you who saw bits and pieces of this before, enjoy it again. This time you can catch the ones that you missed because it went so fast. So what you just saw is a very, very broad scope of photos of your children doing classroom activities, after school activities, before school activities, activities to help them to build team spirit. Many of the activities they do in class, they have to work collaboratively as teams, and everything comes together and works together so that our students are in an environment that is nurturing, that is conducive to learning, where they can collaborate and they can get work done. There is no arguing about anything. As you can see, the students are very versed in their routines. When you looked at the elementary students doing their reader's workshop, you could tell that they are just so very comfortable with the whole concept of reading, but also being able to find that space where they can, in fact, read and practice those skills that the teachers have taught them. East Granby Public Schools are places where students thrive. We focus and we work very hard to ensure that we have the kind of learning environment where we can develop students who are whole and you know, well-rounded experiences that give them an array of competencies that they can use and draw on for all of their learning, no matter what subject area. So this just gives you a snapshot of who we are as a school district. It is a place that is welcoming and a place where we love to learn, because all of us, even the adults, we're all learners. And so what we have is a community of learners, and we learn in an environment and a culture that supports that learning process. And so at this point, without further ado, I want to invite our guest speaker, Janet Garagliano, to join us. And she will tell you a bit more about herself and also a bit more about Mastery Based Learning.
When I talked to Dr. Mahoney about coming here this evening, she gave me a wonderful outline of what the evening was going to be, and she talked about all of the presentations that were going to be on the wall, and she talked about a slideshow that she had. However, after seeing that slideshow, I'm sitting there going, wait, I have to follow that. I know you were sitting there watching for your children. I had the opportunity to watch all the children, and there are just certain things that came through on the screen that I hope you saw as well. For example, the energy. Didn't you just feel the energy in the room as the kids were investigating and digging into whatever the particular subject was? I noticed how the students seemed to be very used to gathering together and working together and being in close with one another. So I got the sense that East Granby is such a tight-knit community, and that's a neat thing to be able to see on the screen. I think it's closing. Yeah, and so it's version 4. Here? Yep.
No,
this one. And from the beginning. Tap it. Perfect. Okay. So as Dr. Mahoney told you, she invited me here today to talk to you a little bit about mastery-based learning. I know that some of you have heard about this before, and some of you are sitting here going, what on earth is mastery-based learning? Well, hopefully by the time we finish this presentation, you'll have a good sense of what it is that we're talking about when we talk about mastery-based learning. But before I get into my actual presentation, earlier, Dr. Mahoney and I were looking at the slideshow that you just saw, and she told me that there was a young man that was part of the science fair, science demonstrations over at the legislative office.
The invention convention.
And that he had an accident, broke a finger, and he had a splint that the doctor put on, and it started to irritate his finger, and he said, wait, this is not acceptable. I don't want something that's going to irritate my finger. So on his own, he came up with a completely different splint that did the job and didn't irritate his finger. And that made me think about this TED Talk that we often use when we give presentations like this, but I didn't use it this evening because it's really kind of long. But the TED Talk is by a professor by the name of Ted Rose. And the proposition of his talk is that schools need to get rid of the myth of average. And he tells a story about the Air Force trying to incorporate new technologies and trying to build this absolutely wonderful, fabulous, multi-purpose aircraft that will have the latest technology and be able to do whatever the Air Force wants aircraft to do with precision and with accuracy. So when it came time to build the cockpit, they knew that they needed to have the chair where the pilot would sit in such a position that the pilot, with ease, and without any confusion or stumbling, particularly in a pressure situation, would be able to get to all of the controls that guided this multi-million dollar piece of machinery that speeds through the air and protects us. So Todd Rose started to think about that, and he said, well, that's really great. When they built this cockpit, they took the average man, took his height, took the ratio of from his shoulders to his waist and his waist to his feet, and they built the seat to fit the average male. So the controls were at arm's length for the average male. And in this TED Talk, the screen switches to a lineup of Air Force pilots, some of whom are short, some of whom are the height of some of our tallest basketball players, some of whom are female, and he says, look, by going to or building around the average, look at all the talent we've left behind. And so when you think about your schools and the schools that you're developing here in East Granby, think about what Todd Rose said. Design to the edges, not to the average, but to the edges. Design schools that will take in all of those youngsters that we saw and meet all of their needs and pique all of their interests and give them every opportunity to soar that you can possibly do. So how are you going to do that? Well, let's see if we can figure out a way. Let's see if I can figure out how this works. Or not. Or we can just do this.
excuse the Adam.
I'm a Mac. There you go, thanks. So I want to get rid of this thing.
There you go.
So. Get so used to my trackpad on my Mac. Mastery-based learning is currently being introduced into almost 30 schools in the state. And sort of peppered throughout this presentation, I've got quotes from students who are very excited about the fact that they're in schools that are giving them this kind of opportunity. So this young woman is a senior at high school in the community, which is one of the magnet high schools in New Haven. There are 5 magnet high schools, and all of them are engaged in some aspect of mastery-based learning. High school in the community was the first school in the state that seriously got involved in mastery-based learning. And I remember going down to that school after their first year. They introduced it to the grade 9 students. That's where their starting point was, grade 9. And I remember going down in June, and I was all excited because I was going to be interviewing students who were going to tell me how great mastery-based learning was. And I walked in, and I got a barrage of students who were like, we hate it. We don't like it. This is terrible. Of course, I was crushed because I had been promoting this, and I was like, oh, this is going to be so great for your school. And I said, why? Why don't you like it? We have to work. We have to think. Before, we used to just sit back, listen to the teacher, daydream, do a few homework assignments, and we'd get a C, and then we'd be fine. Now, in mastery-based learning, they're telling us, can't do that. Can't move on until you've mastered this content. We have to work. I'm like, yeah. So now, those 9th graders are seniors. And this is what they're saying. Makes me appreciate learning more. Now, there are lots of different terms that you can hear about and read about when you start to investigate student-centered learning, proficiency learning, competency learning, mastery-based learning. They're basically all the same thing. And they focus in on making sure that we provide for our students the knowledge, the skills, and the dispositions that they need in order to be successful in whatever it is that they choose to do when they graduate from East Granby High School. How is that different from what you're doing now? Isn't that what you're doing now? One of the things that has made mastery-based learning such a in-demand kind of approach to teaching and learning is because we now live in a world where the economic situation and the technology are coming together. We live in a global society now. We don't live in just, you know, within our own little borders anymore. And so the jobs that your children, the jobs that we saw in that first grade or 6th grade or 11th grade class, the jobs that are there now may not be there when those kids graduate and are ready for the world of work. In fact, we can say with certainty that some of these kids in East Granby right now, probably the elementary level kids, they're going to be doing jobs we haven't even thought of because technology and the economy are changing so rapidly. So, deeper learning, student-owned learning. That's what was happening at high school in the community. Students were beginning to understand that there was a major shift in the way business was done in that school. Because before, teachers were responsible for the learning. Now, students are responsible. And they're in charge. competency-based. Until you master the standards or the competencies that East Granby has decided you need to know and be able to do in order to get a diploma, until you master them, you don't go on. Right now at East Granby High School, a student can get a D minus, pass the course, get the credit, and go on to the next course. In a mastery-based system, you can't go on until you have mastered the standard that the teachers are asking you to master. Lots of support, lots of opportunities, lots of different ways to show that you're learning and to demonstrate mastery. But you don't move on until you've demonstrated you've got it. Competency education, this is another way of talking about it. It's basically all the same thing. Students advance upon mastery. The competencies are explicit, they're measurable, they're transferable. They're learning skills in math that they can use in science, that they can use in English, that they can use in cooking and baking. They're learning skills and knowledge that they'll be able to apply to novel situations, whatever life presents for them. That's something that's different, that we're asking students to take what they learn and apply it. Not just be passive recipients of knowledge, but to be active, to engage in the learning, and to apply what you're learning to novel situations. In the video that we saw before, there was a compare and contrast, and the first grade had a learning wall, and there was a compare and contrast. Do you remember that? It was long ago, today, and then in the intersection, it was today and long ago, where they intersect and where they overlap. Well, here, mastery-based learning and multiple and flexible learning pathways overlap and lead to personalized learning. So you've heard the term personalized learning. Personalized learning does not mean every student gets to do what he or she wants. Far from it. It's a very structured approach. It's based on scientifically proven knowledge around learning and what students need to know and be able to do in order to be successful. But students do have opportunities to create their own pathways. They have a voice in their own learning. And so Josh, who's in the Windsor Locks Middle School, talks to you about why having a voice is important. So when you walk into Windsor Locks Middle School, and Dr. Mahoney told you that I'm going to talk to you a little bit about some of the different communities around you that are using mastery-based system. And each community has done this in a unique way. 7 years ago, about 4 years ago, Windsor Locks decided that the class of 2020 would be the first class that would graduate with a mastery-based diploma. We're no longer going to earn credits, but instead they would demonstrate mastery of standards in all of the different subjects that they needed to learn in order to meet the requirements for the state of Connecticut to get a high school diploma. So they started with grade 6, and then they went to grade 6 and 7 and 5, and then they went to 5, 6, 7, 8, and 4. And so now the middle school is all mastery based. And when they started, they had problems. Because what they learned was that the students in sixth grade were not necessarily where they needed to be a sixth grade student. Some of them had been passed along with certain gaps in their learning, with certain deficiencies in their skills. And so the school had to, the teachers rather, had to decide, what are we going to do? Are we going to continue to pass students along with these gaps and these deficiencies? Or are we going to say, wait, this stops here, this stops now? What do you think they decided? They decided to do all out tilt, and they changed their schedule, and they created a period in the middle of the day that would be devoted entirely to students who needed extra help in order to fill in the gaps to get that extra help. Well, they also realized that there were sixth grade students who really already knew the curriculum for sixth grade. And now they had an opportunity, even though they were in grade six, to go ahead. So in that period in the middle of the day, students who needed support and extra help got it. Students who needed enrichment and an opportunity to go in depth had the time and the opportunity to do that. So everyone's learning needs were being met. So now, those sixth graders are in eighth grade, and in a few months are going to go into high school. And the high school is preparing for those students to come to them. So why do we do mastery-based learning? Listen, East Granby is a successful, thriving, Dr. Mahoney used that word, thriving learning community. Maybe you could do more. So some of the reasons that school districts go to a mastery-based learning is because sure that all of their students graduate college, career, and citizenship ready. When I was principal of Jonathan Law High School, I used to love graduation because that was the culmination of 4 years of hard work on the part of all of our students. And it was a special moment when they walked across the stage. Actually, it was on the field outside. When they walked across the field, and the chairman of the Board of Ed handed that student the diploma. But the reality was, I knew there were some students who were better prepared for whatever was going to happen to them the day after graduation than other students. The mastery-based system ensures that all students who get that diploma are prepared for whatever it is they decide they want to do. So all students succeed. This mastery-based learning is becoming a hot topic, if you will, now because of technology. You saw in this video students who were able to Skype with the author of a book they had just read. The author came into their classroom through that smart board and talked to them. Awesome, how great is that, that they had the opportunity to have a one-on-one conversation with the author. Technology gives us opportunities now that you didn't have when you were in school and that I certainly didn't have when I was in school. And lastly, schools are embracing mastery-based learning because it gives students the flexibility that they need. Because these students now, they live with tablets, right? Everything's to the screen. They know. I have a one-year-old nephew who can pick up the iPhone and do this. He swipes the screen. So with that kind of background and that kind of experience, the technology needs to be able to engage them and intrigue them. And so the timing is right for that. There's a fifth grader from South Elementary School in Farmington. So the standard is the same for everybody, but how you demonstrate mastery of that standard is up to an agreement between the student and the teacher. These are some of I work with the League of Innovative Schools, which is a branch of the New England Secondary Schools Consortium. And so there are schools in the league from New Hampshire, Vermont, Maine, Connecticut, and Rhode Island. I have been involved with this organization for 6 years, and I still don't know why Massachusetts isn't involved, but they're not. They've been invited, but these are some of the reasons that board members in the various schools give for why mastery-based learning is an option that they chose. Look at the first one. 21st century skills like critical thinking, problem solving, teamwork, financial literacy, and technology are essential for success in today's world. When you saw samples of all of those taking place in various corners of the classrooms we saw in the video. In a mastery-based system, all of those, we call them cross-curricular standards, become integrated into the curriculum. So at every turn, students have an opportunity to learn about critical thinking, problem solving. What is mastery-based learning? It consists of state standards. You know that because that's what teachers use now to guide what it is that they teach in their classroom. You know about Common Core. So mastery-based learning continues to rely on Common Core and other state standards. District-decided competencies. So you get to decide the picture of the East Granby graduate. What do you want East Granby students to know and be able to do when they graduate from East Granby High School? And then you create a curriculum and you create instructional practices that allow students to meet the standards, to explore the world around them, explore the world inside them, and stretch their imaginations to the limit. Sean from High School in the Community. I believe this process will get me ready for university and career. So mastery is a student's ability to transfer learning in and across different situations. This is the system of mastery and the way it's set up. We start with 5 to 8 cross-curricular standards, problem solving, communication, things of that sort. From there, we go into different content areas. And you pick 5 or 8 for English. Not 5 or 8 for English 1, English 2. For English, 5 or 8. 5 to 8 for social studies, for phys ed. Now, you know Common Core, there are many more standards in English language arts and math. 5 to 8. But East Granby gets to decide What are the 5 to 8 standards that are so integral to defining what English is or what math is, that we are not going to allow our students to graduate until they have demonstrated mastery of those standards in a variety of ways over time? Whether it's 4 years or 6 years, however much time, over time to a level of mastery. So all standards are important. They all feed into the content area and the cross-curricular standards. But you're picking 5 to 8 in each area that you're going to say, sorry, Mrs. Jones, Sally hasn't demonstrated mastery of this standard, so she's not ready. She can't go yet. We'll get her ready. We'll give her opportunities to learn what it is that she needs to learn, but she's not ready yet. Based on what I saw in the video, you have all the pieces. Your teachers are already teaching 2 standards. Your students are already making choices about what they want to learn and how they want to learn it. So this gives you a framework to bring consistency and coherence to that process, pre-K through 12. Those are the cross-curricular standards that are at the top of the triangle. So I'm going to just skip a whole bunch of this because it's way too... This is what you want to say. One thing I do want to point out here, and the reason I put this slide in, is because one of the nice things about this particular system is what I said before about bringing coherence and consistency to the pre-K through 12 process. So in this case, the grade 5 English language arts standards are aligned with grade 8, are aligned with high school. So it's the same standard, reading comprehension, but the expectation for grade 5 is at this level, the expectation for grade 8 is at this level, and the expectation for high school is at this level. And they all build off of one another. So when the student demonstrates mastery in grade 5, he or she is ready to demonstrate mastery in grade 8. And then again in high school. And the kids know what they're supposed to learn and why. They see this. They know this. English 1 isn't a guessing game anymore. They go, oh, these are the standards I'm responsible for. This is what you expect of me. Okay. This is all, here are some of the schools. I'm sorry I couldn't make it much bigger, but these are the schools that are involved in the League of Innovative Schools. Farmington. Farmington has their entire elementary system on a standards-based mastery format. In Farmington, when parents go to teacher conferences, students run the conference. Students invite their parents in and say, Mom, Dad, I'd like to show you my portfolio. I want to talk to you about what I'm working on. This is what I've done so far. This is what I have yet to do. Completely student run. Talk about owning your own learning.
In Wallingford,
they started with a K-12 continuum. So Wallingford is introducing at all of their schools, including the two high schools, mastery-based learning, and they will make their big launch next year. Naugatuck High School has been doing it for several years now. I told you about Windsor Locks. Ellington, close by, their middle school. Their middle school principal was at a presentation on Friday. He talked about, somebody said to him, how do you define mastery? And he said, well, we have to redefine it every year. Because we take a look at the student work in grade 6, and we think we've defined mastery, then those students go to grade 7, and they do better than the kids last year in grade 7, so they have to ratchet up the expectations. What a great problem that is to have, that your kids are coming, or their kids are coming to them with deeper learning, stronger skills, and teachers now are having to revise the rubrics that they're going to use to measure mastery in student work. It's pretty exciting. And so I included this quote from Lindsay because she talks about self-advocating. And that's one of the earmarks of mastery-based learning. Students are responsible for their own learning, but they also become responsible to find their own voice and to articulate what it is that they need, what they want. So student agency becomes very, very important in this process. On the slide that I made at home, that was all on one line. Questions?
I understand the nature of individual mastery for all students. How do you reconcile this with, number one, graduation requirements from high school, and number two, the timing, the supplying of grades, and admissions to colleges?
Okay, great question. Let's talk about graduation requirements. So the state of Connecticut has determined that there are X number of credits that a student needs to earn in order to get a diploma, and those credits are distributed among a variety of subject areas. That stays the same. We are bound by state law, so any student who's in a mastery-based system will have credits, but they don't get credit by sitting in the seat for 180 days, 42 minutes a day. Instead, they earn that credit by demonstrating that they've mastered the standards that are required for English 1, English 2, English 3, Algebra 2, whatever the subject matter is. So there are those overall math standards, but each individual subject has standards as well. You can't be fluent in Spanish if you haven't done all of the grammar work and the memorization, whatever else is involved in Spanish 1. Spanish 4 or 5 is never going to be accessible to you if you don't do the groundwork. So all of that stays the same. With regard to high school transcripts, and schools vary. And the nice thing about this is that the state of Connecticut supports this. We receive a lot of support from the State Department of Education, but it is not mandated. And as far as Commissioner Wenzel is concerned, it never will be mandated. If the school system wants to adopt it, great. If not, okay. So some of the school systems that have adopted continue to struggle with that question of what shows up on a transcript. What we're hearing And one of the nice things about being part of the consortium is that you can share resources across states. So what we're hearing from colleges and universities throughout New England, and by the way, all of the public, including UConn, all of the public colleges and universities, 2 and 4 year in the state of Connecticut, have signed a pledge that they will honor standards-based report cards and transcripts. In fact, they prefer them. And the reason they prefer them is because when the report tells them that Janet has mastered this standard and outlines what that is, don't they have a much better idea of what I know and can do? Rather than she got an A in English 4, she got a C in algebra, she got a B plus in history. Now they have specific information about what it is that I know and can do. And they love them. The other thing that college admissions folks are saying to us is, you know, we get students who are homeschooled all the time. We get students who come to us from foreign countries, and those transcripts are very different. The key is, if you have, I forget what it's called, if you have an explanation to what your transcript means, and it's understandable to the reader, that's all they need. Was another piece to your question?
The timing, the testing for and admissions to colleges, how do you reconcile that?
So let me tell you the story about high school in the community, and I'll answer your question. High school in the community, I told you, introduced it into grade 9. The first thing they learned was that they had kids who were coming to them with huge learning gaps. Imagine this, it's an inner city school. You would expect that there would be some learning gaps. By the end of grade 9, they made the decision that they were going to hold the line, and they were not going to let kids go into grade 10 until they had demonstrated mastery of the grade 9 standard. And there was a fair number of kids who had not mastered it. They were reading at a grade 5 level. How can they master the grade 9 standard? So those teachers rearranged schedules, so some came in late and stayed late and worked with kids after school. They put in a summer school. They did all kinds of things that they needed to do in order to address those gaps. By the end of October of the next year, all of those ninth graders had mastered the standards. So it gets messy initially, but eventually kids catch up. So you end up with a situation where by the time they get to senior year and they're applying to colleges, most kids are going to be where they need to be. They're going to be caught up and ready to apply to colleges and take the tests that they need to take in order to get into schools. The learning is the same. They're going to know as much, maybe more, probably more, than the seniors or the juniors in the high school down the street. They're just going to get at that learning in a different way. So skill and drill, gone. That doesn't happen anymore. Kids engage with the material in ways that interest them. They learn as much, if not more, just in a different way. Did I get all the questions? Yes, sir.
I'm fascinated with this presentation. It seems to address all of the, or most of the criticisms I've heard about schools in my life. High school certainly didn't operate this way. It seems like you're getting away from the industrial model into almost an entrepreneurial model.
Yeah.
I'm curious. you seem to be focusing on, let's say, school skills in a new way. Are you also looking at a broader picture, say, of community involvement, of perhaps entrepreneurial activity in the sense of starting some kind of small business, and going beyond, let's say, the traditional curriculum?
So one of the things that this allows is for exactly that, because there's now the possibility that if a student's allowed to follow his or her interest, you don't have a course that meets that interest. But maybe there's someone in the community who has a business that meets that interest. You had, I don't remember what grade it was, but you had elementary kids doing coding. Well, wouldn't it be great if they hooked up with someone at UConn or I don't know, wherever, and were able to do, so this opens the door for online learning, this opens the door for internships. In fact, through pressure that we put on the Department of Labor and the State Department of Education, we now have a situation where we have a group of schools that are in a pilot around the whole question of internships and getting kids out into the community during the school day so that they can have that hands-on, real-life experience. And what we're expecting is that they're going to be able to take what they learn in the schoolroom and apply it to novel and unique situations. And then take what they've learned in the business or the entrepreneur environment and bring it back into the classroom and apply it there. So it's a back and forth of give and take. Absolutely, businesses. One of the first things that happens is that communities, and Wallingford's a perfect example. They've opened, they had a building that was, I don't know, there was a business in it, and then they couldn't rent it out or whatever. So the superintendent said, if you give it to me for a year, rent free, I will, it's right in the center of Wallingford, I will bring kids here, and I will bring business people here, and we'll get the kids to work. So they now call it the hub. And they have this student hub where kids leave the school, they go there, and they work with business people. And I don't know how it all works, but the answer is, yeah, schools are doing this, districts are doing this. Yes, ma'am.
I definitely see everything that makes sense about students owning their learning, being advocates for themselves as to what they need to help reach the goals. My concern is wondering, is there a subset of high schools who's already graduated a couple classes where their models and their bumps along the way can be shared with towns that are newer to this?
Absolutely.
And just given the understanding of what a shift it will mean in terms of planning and teaching and assessing and progress monitoring, and just are there districts that show that this really works, mm-hmm. given that it's a huge undertaking to shift in this way?
So you're right, it's a huge undertaking. There are not any districts in Connecticut that have fully implemented this yet, but our friends in New Hampshire, Maine, and Vermont are ahead of us with this. And so there are schools that we look to as models. Some of the questions that I sometimes get has to do with, one of the things that becomes an earmark of this is that we say to teachers, you know how you use, if a student hands work in on time, if a student is cooperative, if a student is,
Compliant.
I didn't want to use that word, but then that seeps into the grade in some way. And what we're saying is, no, you need to separate out academics and all of the affective stuff that's part of being a student. Now, those things are important, right? We want students to be on time. We want them to understand the importance of meeting deadlines. And we want them to know the consequences of when they don't meet a deadline. And all of the other things that we teach kids in a social environment in our schools. Great, we continue to teach those things, but they are not part of an academic grade. They are scored and measured according to a rubric, according to expectations that the school has, in a completely different way. They're part of the report card. Parents get to see whether or not students are growing and maturing in the way that they should, but it doesn't end up being part of their Algebra 2 grade. So, what happens if you have a student who decides, you know, Ms. Grogliano wants this project at the end of October. I don't know if I really want to do it then. I'll do it later. I'll do it later. I'll do it later. And here it is, the end of October. Project's not done. The way in which schools deal with these dispositions, they call it habits of work, is they say to students, and Casco Bay in Maine is the example I'm thinking of, they have trimesters. And in between each trimester, they have a week. And during that week, they have, you know, some of the things you saw here taking place after school? Gaming, scrapbooking, different intramural sports, all these different things that kids are interested in. They have a week where kids can do that for a week, provided they've met all the standards up to that point, and provided that they've completed all the expectations for habits of work. So if they're behind in something, if they haven't done habits of work in a way that's acceptable by the school, they stay at school for that week. And my friend's daughter went out snowshoeing for a week. So she had an interest in that. She wanted to explore it. There were a group of kids who went off with her. They had a teacher advisor. And they went off snowshoeing in the upper regions of Maine. So that's an incentive for kids to get things done on time, to meet the standard, to take it all seriously. So there's ways to work around that. Did I answer your question?
I think you did initially, and then it just brings up a lot of different interesting
more questions. That's good.
What if a kid just doesn't meet the standard, will they be held back? I mean, if they don't make it, with that all that extra help, I mean, that's ideal, but some kids just aren't quite ready, even when they get all that extra help.
Right, so it's a question of readiness, isn't it? And what are we expecting from kids? And so we have to learn how to, we have to learn how to tap into the readiness of that child and push him or her. So is it possible that a student could take English 1 for 1, 2, 3 semesters? Possible. It usually doesn't happen. Usually, most kids finish on time, but there could be a situation where a student would take 3 semesters to finish it.
About first grade, you know, like even at that lower level. You know?
So it's possible that it would take a student a year and a half to get the skills and the knowledge that you've decided are appropriate for first graders to know and be able to do in order to move on to second grade.
So they would be retained then in this kind of a system? Mm-hmm.
However, if it's a student who has an IEP, so certain accommodations, those accommodations still play. They still, you know, they're still a part of that student's learning portfolio. Again, once that transition, that shift that you were talking about happens, students end up getting into it and meeting standards. They do. It's not magic, it just somehow happens.
Is it possible to have, say, a second grader working at a third grade level in some things and a first grade level in other things, but being in second grade, or do they hold them back if they're not meeting first grade standards and everything?
So that becomes a school or a district decision, mm-hmm. and most districts make the decision that moving that student forward makes sense, but the teacher knows that some of the skill development has to be from the first grade curriculum. And maybe that same student, you're right, maybe that same student can do some third grade curriculum. So it just ends up becoming an open-ended kind of process.
Well, it's frustrating.
Go ahead.
Well, it's just frustrating because, you know, many of our children are being tested for IEPs, which then they do not qualify for, but they have other issues. They are getting extra help, but it's still quite difficult.
So I don't know what the curriculum looks like, and I don't know what the instructional strategies are, but one of the things that happens in a mastery-based system is that teachers focus in on those essential skills, and they build their curriculum so that they're stepping stones that lead up to that standard. So if a student, and there's constant monitoring and adjusting, so that if a student is struggling on step three, there's an opportunity to identify instantly almost, but pretty soon, that a student's struggling on step three, and put in the supports that student needs much sooner than happens in a traditional classroom.
Do they, the list that you showed seemingly seem to demonstrate a lot of middle schools and high schools within our state. It didn't seem to show any intermediate or lower elementary schools. Do New Hampshire, Vermont, and Maine actually have elementary schools doing this? Because it seems from a parent of elementary students that this would be extremely difficult to implement in a lower elementary grade school versus where you're in a middle school where you're more specific to this teacher teaches math versus an elementary classroom where you're trying to teach every subject to every child, and having a child at first grade in one area and third grade in another just seems extremely overwhelming from that perspective. So are there actually elementary schools that are using this in those states and have used it, or are they, because when you first mentioned it, you said that they were starting, you know, at sixth grade and then building both ways. Do they have success at that elementary level?
Yes.
They do?
Yep. So Windsor Locks is into intermediate or elementary level. Farmington is standards-based in the elementary, not in the junior high or the high school yet. Sorry, middle school or high school yet. They're moving up to that, but they're into elementary. Yeah. Yes.
You had said that East Granby gets to decide what meets the standard, and it sounded like you were sort of making choices based on the Common Core standards to pick out certain standards. Is that accurate, or?
No, so East Granby gets to decide the picture of the graduate. So each district gets to decide, these are the things that we want our students to know and be able to do to the level of mastery, because if they can't master, they don't demonstrate mastery, we're not gonna let them graduate.
But wouldn't that come from the Common Core?
The building blocks of that become the Common Core in English, Language, Arts, and Math, the Next Gen Standards in Science, the mm-hmm. Social Studies Standards, all the content area standards mm-hmm. that the state of Connecticut has approved and hold teachers responsible for mm-hmm. become part of that picture. But we also recognize, and I think it was Robert Marzano who's a, said, if we held all students accountable to all standards equally, they'd be 33 before they graduated from high school. So what we talk about are identifying power standards, those standards that are so integral to the subject, and that other standards feed into that standard. So it's a way of stacking the standards. So Common Core, still have to meet it, still have to follow the Common Core, but you're stacking the standards in a way that breaks it down so that it's easier for students to demonstrate mastery. Yes, sir.
I feel like I maybe know less about this than most people in this room. So are there tests with this, or are they, is it shy away from testing? And the reason I'm asking this is because some of it I feel like we're bound, right? We have SATs, almost all colleges and universities are test-based. I'm an actuary, all of I take tests up the wazoo, and they're all graded. So is some of it forced upon us where it's a world of testing? Not that you have to go to college or to be successful by any means. He mentioned entrepreneurship, but so is some of it, is it more of like, well, we want all our kids to be entrepreneurs instead of actuaries, or how is this, I'm trying to understand that dynamic,
okay. I guess. So the state of Connecticut has policies around tests that kids need to take in order to, I don't know, it's mandated. So SAT in grade 11, SBAC in grades, the lower grades. So those are still there. Those aren't going to go away. But the assessments that become a part of this way of teaching and learning are still, well, we call them summative. So it's like a test. It's like a chapter test or a unit test at the end of, you know, the American, whatever, World War I. You had a unit test at the end of, you know, you studied World War I, you had a unit test at the end. It's the same kind of summative assessment, but it is closely aligned to the standards that those students had to study in that unit. So it's also different in the sense that I might decide that I want to do my summative assessment on World War I by creating a video. You might decide that you want your summative assessment to be a report. Or, you know, there's the opportunity for me to demonstrate how I learn best, to tell you, the teacher, I've mastered these standards. I get to communicate that to you in a way that fits in with my learning style, or in a way that meets my interest. So at the beginning of a unit, a teacher might say, okay, boys and girls, today we're going to learn about the Civil War. And we're going to learn about the causes and the effects of the Civil War. I want you to be thinking about a summative assessment. How are you going to demonstrate to me that you've mastered all of the standards that are a part of this unit of U.S. history? And then we have conversations. The teacher guides the student by saying, you want to make a video, that's great, but do you have the equipment? Do you have the skills? Do you have the knowledge? So, I mean, it's guided by the teacher, but there's a lot more flexibility and choice that the student has.
So rather than like an A through an F, it's a yes or a no. Either you mastered or you didn't.
Well, some schools are using, frankly, a lot of schools are saying that there is no F, that it's not yet. So you haven't failed it, you just haven't mastered it yet. And they're using A, B, C, D, whatever they use. There are other schools that are using 1, 2, 3, 4. One is you're approaching, 4 is mastering. And the rubric sort of breaks down what a 1 means, what a 2 means, what a 3 means, what a 4 means. The nice things about these rubrics is that you give them to the students and they know right away what they have to do in order to get a 1, a 2, a 3, or a 4. It's explained to them. They know it from the beginning.
I'm sorry, I'm confused. Is this something we're doing and you're letting us know? Or is this something we're gonna be involved with helping to create, or and you're asking us, or is, like, I'm just confused about where this is going and what the intention of this?
I think the intention of this, and all right, Dr. Mahoney.
Go ahead. This is an informative session. I think Janet already shared that, you know, our work up to this point has put us in a position where we have all of the integral pieces to move forward in this direction. The Common Core standards are not new. We have always used the Connecticut frameworks, now called standards. They've been updated, but it's the same thing. We have already put in place standard rates report cards in the elementary level. That's already there, you're used to that. We have been doing formative and summative assessments. We've integrated our technology in ways that our learners can use the technology independently as a tool for learning. That's not new to East Granby. So we have also been very diligent about engaging our faculty in job-embedded professional development. The teacher's college model, if you watched, you saw students, even though these quotas were still, you really saw students taking ownership of their work. Students were reading independently. When you looked at the video, the section on Genius Hour or Read Aloud, you saw students taking ownership of their work. Those students in the Genius Hour video, they met with their teachers, they talked about what they wanted to do, the teachers told them what they needed to include. The students developed their own plan for what they wanted to do during that time period. They identified the resources that they needed. Okay, I need my Chromebook, I need the book that I'm reading, I need paper. If it's an experiment, I need to go get all the pieces that I need. I'm learning Braille, I need to go do some research on Braille, I need to have a Chromebook here, etc. So our students are already in this mode of learning, and I think that is powerful in terms of getting started in this direction, because it means that they already have the mindset, if you will, to make a more natural transition than if they were in a school district where they never had any of what you saw. So we have not stepped forward to say, okay, we're starting this today. That is not where we are. This is part of the process. And part of this session is important because we want you, our community, to know what we're thinking about. We want you to know where we are, what our students are doing, what we already know, what they already know, what they're already able to do. A lot of the attributes, skills, and dispositions they already have. So they are poised, if you will, to make this next transition. So this is an informative session. Mastery-based is, you know, it's a new term, it's a new concept, and it's, you've probably heard it in various places. This is your opportunity, it was your opportunity, still is, for a few moments before we move to the next thing. But this is your opportunity to speak with someone who's lived it, who's seen it at work in other states, who's seen it at work in other districts in the state of Connecticut. She knows the slips and falls, and so could guide us if, in fact, when we choose to fully go down this path. So that's the purpose of this evening. We want you to be informed. We don't want to just step out there and everybody saying, whoa, what is that? We don't know about that. What are you doing to my kid? No, we want you to be informed. We want you to be a part of this. The children will come home, you know, you'll watch them or help them with the homework or something else that they're working on. And you want to feel like you know what's going on so that you can be a part of it. And you can help your learners to meet those standards. You can help them to interpret the rubric. Even though I'm sure the teachers will do a good job explaining that, but isn't it so much nicer when you can sit shoulder to shoulder with your child and work through that assignment that they're working on? So that's the rubric.
And the beauty of this is that, and Dr. Mahoney's absolutely correct, you're already so poised. You're already almost there. And you can, there are different ways to go about doing this. So the way in which East Granby does it is going to be unique to the culture and the values that are already an integral part of this community. So it's not going to be a disturbance. If anything, it's going to be a way to bring some coherence, to bring a kind of alignment pre-K through 12 that probably already exists, but now you have a chance to bring it into sharper focus. Yes, ma'am.
So get a lot of information and communication in the community about all the accolades that East Granby has in our schools and awards and AP exams that kids are taking and mastering and our graduation rate here in town. And if these are things, as Dr. Mahoney said, that we are already doing, we already have, and we have all these accolades in happening, which is a large reason why my family moved to this town, which I've mentioned before at many community meetings. Why the change? Why is the district choosing now to look for a different way of teaching our kids? Because I don't know that I would necessarily choose sharpening the lens as maybe what it might look like, because I feel like maybe I'm the creation of rubrics and standards are time consuming things. I feel like our kids are rock stars in East Granby. I guess my question is why?
That's a very good question and very good observation, so thank you for acknowledging the hard work that everyone has been doing. But here's the thing. We want, when our students leave here, that they are competitive. We don't want our students leaving here not knowing what their peers are doing or what their peers have done. Rubrics are not new to us. We've had rubrics for forever, so that's not a new thing to students or to us or staff. The kind of assessments that we're doing, that's not new either. So this is an opportunity for us to pull all the pieces together so that students can move through this learning experience in our schools more seamlessly. Things come together. They fall into place and they can connect their learning. You know, the way things are structured now, we still pretty much have a traditional high school. Math's over here, English is over here, social studies over here, history's over here, you know, technology, education is over here, music is over here. You know, God forbid we should ever connect those dots and give a student the opportunity to bring to bear all of the skills that they've learned in all of those areas in a project that demonstrates that they're phenomenal and that they have mastered all of those learning standards in an incredible way. Powerful way. What we want is to keep getting better. We're not going to dismiss the things that are working for us. Up to this point, we have been very judicious about making sure that what we do is value added, and that has paid off, and that's not going to go away. That will always be our mantra. If it doesn't make us better, we're not doing it. But we have to be informed about that process of determining what is going to be value added to us. So we have to look at these other elements, because in as much as we want to think that our students are okay, they're fine as they are, we don't know what next year brings. We don't know by the time they get to college what they're going to encounter. We don't know by the time they get to work what they're going to encounter. We don't want them being left behind. We want our students to be right up there or above their peers. That's what we strive for. And in the process, we try to balance that, give them a well-rounded learning experience and opportunity here in our school so that they feel like fully developed, well-educated individuals.
do have a question. I was just thinking about, like, if you're looking for mastery and some of the children are not at that mastery point, and you have a class and you're teaching, like, world history, and so World War I, they're not into mastery yet. Would the teacher continue on with the class, and then what would those children who have not met mastery be doing? And would there be additional support, and what would that look like, and how would we get the money to have additional support in our town that, you know, doesn't really pass a budget from year to year? So that was kind of my concern.
Great question. And here's the neat thing. We already have that support structure in place.
Oh.
And if you watch the way that our teachers work with our students, if Mary doesn't quite understand us, our teachers will take the time to work with Mary before school, after school. We have tutors, we have intervention specialists, we have other tutors and interventions through our scientific research-based intervention models. Phenomenal resources. We've trained they're not many, but we've trained them to the point where they are incredibly effective in helping our students. We do that now. Every teacher in our district, I can vouch for them, takes the little extra time to help each child to be successful. That is not going to change. It won't change. That's what makes us who we are.
What this could do, open some doors, open some windows to students so that they get to follow a passion and interest in a way that's structured, coherent, cohesive.
You know, think about when you were in school and you're studying a particular topic, everybody had to write an essay. As a student, if I didn't feel I was a great writer, my personal preference would be that my teacher allow me to go out, interview some people about that topic, make some notes, maybe take some photographs, and choose a different way to demonstrate that I have mastered this. I may not have chosen to write an essay, but look how much more I learned by doing it the way I did. This gives students options to demonstrate. Not that we don't want them to be good writers, but we should
still have to be good writers.
Yeah, absolutely. But we shouldn't stymie a student's interest in learning by locking them into a single mode of demonstrating what they know and are able to do.
I actually can see the benefits in this, and I like it, and I think it probably could work. I think my concern from what I'm hearing is there any concern with kids not being ready for college after this? Because I feel like it's students get to do what they want to do, and oh, I don't want to write an essay, can I do something else? And I don't want to do this by October, but oh, maybe I will so I can have a bonus week. When you get to college, that doesn't really exist. There's deadlines.
Absolutely.
You don't get the choice to do something different.
Yeah.
So that's the only thing I'm worried about.
Well, the interesting thing is this is based on mastery. They have the master. So even the student who would prefer not to write, teachers find a way to get the students to A, develop the confidence in their own skills, and teach them other ways of approaching their writing. So eventually they do master all of these.
So the answer is the teachers in the school become much more aware of what kids actually know and can do and make sure that they learn what it is that they need to know and be able to do so that they can be successful. So students aren't going to graduate until they're ready. And most students are going to be ready at the end of grade 12. But it's a way of taking what they need to know and what they need to be able to do, identify it, call it what it is, develop curriculum and instructional practices around it, and make sure that kids get it, so that when they go on to college or to work or to wherever it is that they're going to go, they're ready.
We'll take one last question, and then I want to try to move us along. I know it's almost at the witching hour, but I do want maybe another 15 minutes of your time before we leave.
I had a friend in high school who looked at the earnings from his part-time job was buying college graduate level math textbooks and devouring them as fast as he could. He maxed the SATs, and really he spent most of his time in high school being kind of bored. And I really want to ask you, how far do you let independent study go with this? I mean, if you had, let's say, a Bill Gates who was lucky enough to have a computer laboratory at a time when very few high schools have them, and he spent the $10,000 necessary to master it, as Malcolm Gladwell says in his book, Tipping Point. I mean, how far do you let them go with independent study? If you have somebody, let's say, who is well ahead of standard in several areas, how much time can they spend on that? How do they allow for kids like that?
So I think that becomes a local decision. That's the beauty of this, is that the local entity has the ability to make the decision around what's appropriate. You know, you take a look in the communities around you and what resources are there for a kid like that, and you match them up. And you know, those are going to be some tough questions that the educators are going to have to deal with. But what a great problem to have and try to solve. So, you know, I don't know the answer, because we don't know the specifics of what you're talking about, but at least there's an opportunity to have that conversation now.
I think I can shed a little light on that. Right now, we have established partnerships with local colleges and universities. So if we have a student who is progressing at a rate such that they exceed what we offer within our schools, we have College Now program, we have partnerships with several colleges around, and we have had students in the past whom we have accelerated through to take those college courses and get on the college campus. So we work with the students. One of the great things about being in a school system such as ours is we all work to find additional resources to help our students, and we have great partnerships out there, and we are able to work with students to meet their needs. We find a way to make it happen.
Teacher, thank you so much.